15 seconds, Julie. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two, one.
Thank you. Please join me for our opening prayer. Father, Advent is a time to prepare our hearts for Christmas. Let the spirit of wisdom and understanding, of counsel and of might, of knowledge and of fear of the Lord be with us and direct us during this special season of celebration for the gift of Jesus. Help us to understand and obey you by listening and paying attention to the Holy Spirit's presence in us as followers of Jesus Christ. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning. My name is Matt Dietrich. I am the Director of Youth Ministries here at Nicholasville United Methodist Church, and we are so glad that you are joining us for our online worship service this morning. I have just a few announcements to highlight for us this morning. The first is that we will be doing our Sunday drive-through offering. That will be today from noon until 1 in the church parking lot. Ministry and mission still continue here at NUMC, although it might look a little bit different right now, and so we still do need your support. Under the current circumstances, you can continue to give through snail mail, or you can give online going to our church website. It's numcky.org, and at the top right corner of the webpage, you'll see a Give Online link. Click on that, and it will take you to a secure giving page where there are different options as to how you can give. It's a great option for you to utilize during this time of pandemic. Do you have a favorite scripture passage that you would like to hear Pastor Wade preach on? 2021 is the year of the living lectionary, and we're asking you to submit scriptures that you would like to hear preached on in the coming year. You can submit those requests by calling the church office, by emailing them to the office at numcky@gmail.com, or you can list those on the church Facebook page. And finally, Pastor Wade is leading a video discussion Bible study on Wednesday evenings called Life Song, The Melody of Your Heart. If you want to be a part of this special Advent Bible study that Pastor Wade is leading, you can email him. His email address is numcpastor@gmail.com. Or you can call the church office and let him know that you would like to be a part of it, and he will send you the virtual meeting link so that you can be a part of it. And now we have a special Advent reading from the Combs family.
Hi, we're the Combs family, and this week we add the candle of joy to our Advent wreath. But what is joy? It's like happiness, but so much better. Joy is deeper and more lasting. Happiness comes and goes, but joy is planted deep within us, like an underwater river that never stops flowing, filling us up in good times and in bad. We don't always feel happy as Christians, and that's okay. We're allowed to be sad sometimes, and even Jesus wept. But God promises us joy in this life, and the joy that comes from knowing that God holds the future in his hands. We're able to feel joyful in good times and in bad because we know who is seated at the throne of heaven, and his name is Jesus. And we can rejoice because in him, the victory is already won. That's why Christmas is something to get excited about. It's the birth of our King.
This week, everyone likes free candles on their every night.
Today's scripture, Luke 1:46-49. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name."
Let's pray. Oh God, you are the joy of our life. We pray that you would give us the gift of joy so that we might bring joy to others, especially in this Christmas season, which can be a sad time for so many people. Help us to be joyful in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And I have a prayer too.
Oh, okay.
Let God hear everything we say, and let us, and this is one of the best years. Everybody has their stockings up and Santa comes, and we hope everybody safe. Amen.
Amen.
Bye. Bye.
To follow that. That was awesome. Thank you, Combs family. Will you join me now in our call to worship? It is from Micah chapter 5, verses 2 through 5. "But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore, he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace."
Sing we the song of Emmanuel. is the Christ who has long foretold. Lo, in the shadows of Bethlehem, promise of dawn, now our eyes behold. God Most High in a manger lay. Lift your voices and now proclaim. Great and glorious love has come to us. Join now with all the heaven. Come we to welcome Emmanuel, King who came with no rule or throne. Helpless he lay with an invincible Maker of Mary, now Mary's son. Oh, on wisdom to save us all, shepherds, sages before him fall. Grace and majesty, what humility. Come on, bended knees, adore him. Spread the news of Emmanuel, joy and peace for the weary heart. Lift your heads, for the King has come. Sing, for the light overwhelms the dark. Glory shining for all to see. Hope alive, let the gospel ring. God has made a way, he will have the praise. Go tell the world his name is Jesus. Glory shine for all to see. Hope alive, let the gospel ring. God has made a way, he will have the praise. Go tell the world his name is Jesus.
God by name, oh, tidings of God.
and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. He has come for us, this Jesus. He has hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah.
We shall be called Jesus. I don't know about you, but I love singing all the Christmas songs, new ones, old ones, the special music. It's an amazing time of year as we get to celebrate Advent and Christmas together, even if online. I'm Pastor Wade, and it's time in the service where we get ready to go into our prayer time. I want to share a couple of requests and some celebrations, and then we'll be invited together into a time of prayer, and we'll close out that time together praying the Lord's Prayer. So a couple things just to highlight as we get going this morning. We are certainly celebrating what's been in the national news, news of a coming vaccine. That seems like great news after a very long 2020. So we are anxious for that to be deployed and hopefully to begin working and helping us begin the slow, steady stream of getting back to normal. As a church, we celebrate. This is kind of different. Earlier this week, we had about 10 people gathered here in the sanctuary, and we celebrated the baptism and membership of Edward Rosenthal. So celebration, praise and thanksgiving to Edward. And we're just rejoicing another person's not only come into the family of faith here at the church, but into God's kingdom as well. So we're celebrating that as well. I know for many folks right now, it is the last week of school before Christmas break. And I know that feels like a celebration too. Now, granted, it's been online school and teachers have been teaching in various capacities. I know for a fact, having talked to a few of them, teachers and students, everyone's ready, I think, for Christmas break. We also want to remember a couple of requests that just came in very recently. We want to pray for Jay. Prayers also for Susan. And we also want to lift up the family of Wanda Quillen. Wanda passed away about a week ago, and we celebrated her funeral this past Friday, 2 days ago. So prayers for the Quillen family. Friends, at this time, I would invite you, let's just find a moment where we can kind of pause and be still. Let's humble our hearts and bow our heads and go before our amazing Heavenly Father. We approach the throne of grace and pray in the name of Jesus. My friends, this morning, would you join me as we pray together? Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thank you for this season of Advent, a time of waiting and preparation. Thank you, Lord, for the reminder of hope and peace and joy and love. Thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus. At Christmas time, we celebrate you, Lord Jesus. You came out of the eternal and into our world, and you made your first home as stable. Come, Lord, and make your home right here in our hearts, in our time of worship. During a year that has been especially difficult, and during a season right now where the days are getting shorter and the darkness of night is getting longer, remind us, Lord Jesus, how you are the eternal light. Lord, help us who have lived in darkness to see your light in the faces of your people, Lord, as you light up our hearts. Lord, this Advent and Christmas season also, remind us of the joy of the miraculous. Help us to believe once again, Lord, the power through the Holy Spirit, miracles of love and forgiveness, redemption and reconciliation, how these gifts still happen today. Lord, in our hearts, in our churches, and even across our nation. Thank you, Lord, for the miraculous trust that those ancestors of faith before us placed in you, people like Mary and Joseph, Elizabeth and Zechariah. Thank you for the songs of the angels and, Lord, the worship of the wise men. Lord, today we thank you for your miracles of healing and redemption, grace and steadfast love, your comforting touch, second chances and new beginnings. Thank you, Lord, for the miraculous birth of baby Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the miracle of Christmas. Today, Father, we pray that you would heal the sick and comfort those who suffer and welcome those whose hearts are far from you, but who respond in grace. Lord, lead us and guide us and fill us. Pour out your Holy Spirit and fill us up, full to overflowing. Lord, we confess that you are our God and we are your people. Breathe your presence now into our lives. Slow us down and remind us of your peace on earth. Help us to place ourselves truly in your hands. And today, Father, we pray you would fill our hearts with joy. All these things we ask and all these things we offer back. In the mighty name of Jesus. And we take time now to remember the words that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. When together they prayed by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen.
Thank you.
Today's scripture reading comes from Luke chapter 1, verses 45 to 56. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with Elizabeth about 3 months and then returned to her home. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Would you pray with me again, please? Almighty God, we thank you for your word, how it calls to us and how it challenges us. Lord, how it brings us comfort. Lord, how it draws us ever more near to you. Lord, speak to us today in a fresh way. Thank you for music that stirs our souls. Thank you for the reading of your word. And now, Father, as we come to your word once again, we pray that it might just speak to us afresh. We love you, and we give you this day for your purpose and for your glory. It's in Jesus' mighty name we ask and pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. We have a lot of musically gifted people in the room today as we are recording. And so I thought maybe y'all could help me kind of get started, kind of an introduction to the sermon here. I want to play part of a song, but y'all need to help me kind of fill it out. I got to find the right key here. I've got my first kind of cold of the year coming on, so the voice isn't the best. Y'all may have to help me out a little bit here, okay? So let me go through this here a little bit here and see if y'all can help me here, okay? Oh, that's much better right there. Ready? Here we go. To the world the Lord is come. Let earth receive. I missed something. Did y'all, the first word there? Okay. Let me try this again. Happy to the world, the Lord is come. Is that close? Yeah, I got the, okay, let's, another one here. It's a little harder. Gladness to the world, the Lord is come. Getting better? Yeah. Going the other way? This is a $5 word here. You ready? Here we go. Exaltation to the world, the Lord is come. Better? Worse? Vince is just staring at me like, no. How about this one? Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth, yeah, that's right, okay. So here's the question. Why do you think Isaac Watts, the writer of the hymn, Joy to the World, why do you think he picked the word joy? Of all the really good positive words you could start out with, why pick joy? Now, being lazy, I would say joy, it's three letters, simple to spell, one syllable, probably rhymes with things. That's probably not the right answer, right? Why did he pick joy? In the scripture that Matt read, in the scripture that was also in our Advent reading, why do you think that Mary said these words, "My soul," she didn't say re-happies or re-glads. She said, "My soul rejoices. My soul rejoices in God my Savior." I think when it comes to this idea of joy and happiness, I am all for happiness. 2020, we need some happiness, don't we? It's been a crazy year. But I think the Bible is calling us to something deeper than happy. And I think the Bible is pointing us towards joy. And turns out they're a little different. I mean, we use them interchangeably. But I would suggest to you this morning that there's a reason that the Bible spends so much time talking about joy. It's not that God doesn't want us happy. I don't think that's it at all. But God wants us to know joy. So for a few minutes this morning, let's do three things very quickly and very simply. One is talk about this slight and subtle difference between happiness and joy. And then talk about what it takes to move beyond happiness to come to a place of joy. And by the way, as we are going through our message series in Ebenezer Christmas for a Scrooge World, turns out there's a great passage at the end of Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol that gives us an example of, I think, moving past happiness and coming into a place of joy. We'll look at that just for a second. And then we'll kind of close with this idea of, well, what does it take to choose joy? In the middle of 2020, in the middle of pandemic, what does it mean for you and I intentionally to choose joy? So three things very simply. The first thing, let's just jump into it, is this. What is the difference between happiness and joy? I'd say there is a difference. It's subtle, but it's significant. In the Advent reading, the Combs family read some of these words. Let me rephrase part of that for you. Joy, it's like happiness, but so much better. Joy is deeper and more lasting. Happiness comes and goes, but joy is planted deep within us like an underwater river that never stops flowing, filling us up in good times and bad. God promises joy in this life, and that joy comes from knowing that God holds the future in His hands. Happiness is good, right? But joy is something a little bit different. If you think about like a spectrum, a continuum, and you've got maybe happy on one side and joy on the other, there's a few key differences. So for example, happiness is rooted in circumstance. Nothing wrong with that, but happiness is rooted in the circumstance, what's happening right now. But joy is actually rooted in character, and in particular, in the character of God. Rooted in circumstance, rooted in character. A couple differences, right? Also, happiness, for example, is about what's happening in the moment. So like what's happening right now. But joy is something bigger. It goes beyond just what's happening in the moment right now. It's bigger. It's beyond just today, just right now. And then finally, with happiness, let's just be honest, the focus is mainly on us. It's about us being happy, me being happy, or you being happy. But joy is the idea, very simply, of focusing beyond ourselves. And as Christians, we talk about focusing on God first, right? So think about these kind of compare and contrast. And think about your own life. I mean, would you rather choose to live your life in a way where you're responding based on circumstances, based in the moment, and based on yourself? Or live in a way where you're responding based on the character of God, based on more than just now or today, and based on who God is, not necessarily who we are. Now, I got to admit, it's kind of a shift in perspective, right? Going from happy to joy, but it kind of makes sense if you think about it. So imagine, you know, that it's springtime or summertime, whatever, and you're outside and a huge thunderstorm comes upon you and you're caught in the rain without an umbrella and you are soaking wet. Now, for some of us, that might be an unhappy moment, right? I'm all wet and my clothes and this. But from the perspective of joy, you could say, you know what? At least my garden is getting some good water right now, right? It's looking beyond just yourself. Or go to maybe a different example. 2 days ago, on Friday, we held a short visitation right here in our sanctuary for the Quillen family. And then we drove to a cemetery and had a graveside outdoor service. In that moment, there was both sadness and joy. Well, how can that be? How can you be both sad and joyful? Well, honestly, you know, there was tears of sadness because we were missing Wanda, you know, and we told stories and we remembered and we read scripture and we played songs. There was sadness. We're missing her. But there's also joy because she was a believer. And we know we have this hope that she is with Jesus right now in heaven, right? So on the one hand, we can be unhappy because we're sad, we're missing a loved one, a friend, a family member, a church member, but we can be rejoicing because she's gone on to be in a better place. You see, happiness and joy are not quite the same. Or take the scripture, for example, and the larger story of the angel coming to Mary and telling her this news about her going to have this child, this blessed little boy. If you know anything about the first century in Judea, a young woman who wasn't married, who was found to be with child, and there was question about who the father was, that was a really bad situation for a young woman to be in. Under the Old Testament laws and customs, she could have been in a lot of trouble. Worse, she could have maybe even been killed. And yet she responded to the angel by saying, "My soul rejoices," right? On the one hand, her knowing the culture, this might not have been a happy moment. I've got a lot of explaining to do. But she could respond to the angel, "My soul rejoices." You see, there's a difference between happiness and joy. And really, if you dig in and push deep, it has to do with trust. It has to do with, where do you place your trust? In whom do you place your trust? And really the question is, do you place your trust in God or in someone or something else? And by the way, in the big things in life and the difficult things in life and the troubling things in life, when we place our trust in someone or something else, so often we can be let down, and that leads to worry and stress and anxiety. When you place your trust in God, according to the Bible, that's where the sense of joy comes from. God is bigger than us and bigger than this moment and bigger than the circumstance, bigger than this time. And the issue is about His character, not about what we're going through in this moment. So really, when you think about it, if we want to experience lack of some stress and lack of some anxiety and lack of some worry, we've got to place that trust in Christ alone. And the Bible says that's this fountain, that's the source of the joy. Now, I'm all for happiness, don't get me wrong, but if we want to experience that deeper joy, it's really about, who do you trust? Trusting in ourselves? Okay. Trusting in others? Okay. But trusting in God, that's the source of true joy. Friends, where do you place your trust? Well, let's look at this in a literary example for just a second. In Charles Dickens' book, A Christmas Carol, there's an image, a picture, if you will, towards the end of the book, and I think it's a beautiful picture, a beautiful image, of what it looks like to be happy, but then also to move from happiness into joy. Let me give you the breakdown, the setup here real quickly. So if you've ever, you know, read the book, A Christmas Carol, or seen any of the movies or the remakes and all that, you know that by the end of the story, after Ebenezer Scrooge's long night, and it turns out it's Christmas Eve, this long night where he's visited by these different spirits, the ghost of Christmas past and the ghost of Christmas present and the ghost of Christmas future, at the end of all that, he kind of has a change of heart and a change of life. And in the last chapter, chapter 5, or stave number 5, as Dickens titled it, we get a fresh glimpse of Ebenezer Scrooge, right? Remember, before he was, remember the passage I read last week, he was basically solitary as an oyster. Didn't want to be around anybody, right? But we get a different, fresh picture of him here. Something has happened to change him, and I won't give it away. You can read the book. You can watch any of the number of movies yourself. But listen to the description of Scrooge when he wakes up on Christmas morning. Something has happened. Let me read this to you. It's about a page long. "Yes! And the bedpost was his own, and the bed was his own. The room was his own. Best and happiest of all, time before him was his own to make amends." Scrooge said, "I will live in the past and the present and the future," he repeated as he scrambled out of bed. "The spirits of all three shall strive within me. Oh, Jacob Marley, heaven and the Christmas time be praised for this. I say on my knees, oh, Jacob, I say on my knees." Scrooge was so fluttered and so glowing with his mood of good intentions that his broken voice would scarcely answer to his call. He'd been sobbing violently in his conflict with the spirit, and his face was wet with tears. Scrooge cried, "They're not torn down," folding one of the bed curtains in his arms. "They're not torn down, rings and all. They are here. I am here. And the shadows of things that would have been may be dispelled. They will be. I know they will." His hands were busy with his garments all this time, turning them inside out, putting them on upside down, tearing them, mislaying them, making them into parties of every kind of extravagance. "I don't know what to do," cried Scrooge, laughing and crying in the same breath, making a perfect Laocoon of himself with his stockings. He said, "I am light as a feather. I'm happy as an angel. I'm merry as a schoolboy. I'm giddy as a drunken man. A merry Christmas to everybody. A happy new year to the world. Hello here. Whoop. Hello." Isn't that good? This is not the grumpy, crotchety, angry, bitter Ebenezer Scrooge we knew in the rest of the story. Something here has happened. Now, if you read the rest of it, which we're not going to do right now, but if you read the rest of it, you'd see that in these next moments, Scrooge is so happy and so elated, so excited about this second chance he has to do things right. But then a subtle shift takes place. If you were to read a little bit further, you would see that Scrooge's attention moves from himself, and he begins to look outside the window and think of others. In particular, the rest of the story is about how Scrooge is going to reach out and bless the Cratchit family, and you can read about that, and then also the family of his nephew. The rest of the book is about how Scrooge is going to get beyond himself in this happy moment, and I would argue, live into joy, because he's focusing on others, he's blessing others. This moment has become bigger than just himself. He's reaching out in love and grace, care, compassion, charity, generosity to all these other people, namely the Cratchit family, namely his nephew. It's an amazing story. He's happy, but he moves beyond happy to joy. You know, if you want to think of 2020, like going to the eye doctor, 2020 vision, and I know it's 2020 pandemic, but if you want to think of things in perspective and things in order, think of the word joy. Three simple letters, J-O-Y. And let J stand for Jesus. Focus on Jesus first. And let the O stand for others. Focus on Jesus first, then focus on those around you, other people. And then Y, yourself, last. If you order your heart and order your priorities in that J-O-Y, in that joy perspective, you're going to have real joy, right? Because your life, your heart, your mind, everything is lined up. Jesus first, God first, the benefit, well-being of others next, and then ourselves last. Just a thought, an easy way to think about how you maintain joy, not just in the Christmas season, but all throughout the year. So let's kind of land the plane here and talk about what does it mean for us, you and I, to choose joy. And I know it's 2020. And I know it's pandemic. But what if we thought about this idea of choosing joy, trading the frustration, the hurt, the whatever it is in our life, trading that to God and receiving in its stead joy, true joy. There's a great quote that says, "Those who leave everything in God's hands will eventually see God's hands in everything." Let me say it again. Those who leave everything in God's hands will eventually see God's hands in everything. Imagine just putting everything into God's hands, giving it to Him, and then seeing what He offers back to us. And I would suggest to you that part of what He offers back to us is a trade, trading the burdens for joy. In fact, there's a great little verse in Isaiah chapter 61 that talks about trading one thing for another. In Isaiah 61 verse 3, there's this talk about what God is going to do for His suffering people. And it says in Isaiah 61 verse 3, He's going to give them beauty instead of ashes. He's going to give them gladness instead of mourning. He's going to give them praise instead of weakness. Isn't that a great trade? You give to God one thing and He gives you back something else. I will give them a garland of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and the mantle of praise instead of a faint and weak spirit. Those, by the way, are good trades, right? What about in our life today? What would we be willing to trade God here in 2020 to put in His hands and then see His hands at work in all things in our lives? As we trust Him, we get to live into and experience that joy. Think about the storms of life. Well, whatever storm of life is happening right now. Maybe it's health related. Maybe it's relationships. Maybe it's with your job or something with your neighbors. Probably all of us are experiencing some kind of storm. And maybe you just call it 2020, the pandemic year of 2020. Well, imagine trading that. Could you place that entire thing into God's hands? And could you find joy? By trusting God, could you find joy that the same hands that calmed the storms of the Sea of Galilee can calm those storms in my life and your life as well? Would you be willing to trade that to God this year? What about this? The burdens. We're all carrying something, right? A bag of bricks on our shoulder that's heavy, weighing us down. A bunch of stones are dragging behind us that represent regrets or mistakes, frustrations, loss. I mean, it can be anything, right? But all of us from time to time end up carrying burdens. And maybe we're afraid to let them go. Maybe we can't let them go. Well, what if we chose joy this Advent and Christmas and made a trade? We placed those burdens into God's hands and let Him take those and carry those for a while. And imagine those hands that welcomed the children and healed the sick and fed those who were hungry, those same hands would help you carry that burden for you. Wouldn't that be a great joy? Trusting in God and receiving back that joy? Can you find joy in trusting in those same hands that reached up out of the manger, or the same hands that were nailed to the cross to bring us forgiveness and a second chance and hope and new life and salvation? You see, my friends, the corrective for worry, for anxiety, for stress, it's not happiness, as great as happiness is, it's joy. Because it comes from trusting in God, placing ourselves and everything we have, everything we are, into God's hands. That's why Mary could cry out and say, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." And that's why we, you and I today, can sing with full hearts and clear minds. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare Him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world. Pray with me. Our Father and our God, we thank You for blessings. We thank You for hope. We thank You for love. We thank You for peace. And today, especially, we thank You for joy. Father, help us to have the courage and to have the deep faith to trade those worries, to trade those burdens, to place them in Your hands, to give them over to You, and receive back what You have for us, joy, celebration in the name of Jesus. All these things we ask, all these things with faith we give over to You in the mighty and awesome and powerful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And with one heart, with one voice, all God's people said, amen and amen.
As we close our worship service, let's sing the hymn, "Tell Out My Soul." This is an unfamiliar one in the hymnal, so we're going to sing it to the tune of "God of Our Fathers." Let's all sing, "Tell Out My Soul."
Tell out out my soul the greatness of the Lord. Unnumbered blessings give my spirit voice, tender to me the promise of God's word. In God my Savior shall my heart rejoice. Tell out my soul the greatness of God's name. Make known God's might, whose wondrous deeds has done. God's mercy sure, from age to age the same. God's holy name, the Lord the Mighty One. Tell out my soul the greatness of God's might. Powers and dominions lay their glory by. Proud hearts and stubborn wills are put to flight. The hungry fed, the humble lifted high. Tell out my soul the glories of God's word. Firm is the promise, God's at mercy sure. Tell out my soul the greatness of the Lord. To children's children and forevermore.
As our benediction and closing prayer, let me read for you just the first four lines of what turned out to be not only our scripture reading, but also our Advent reading today. Hear these words as a prayer, as a blessing over us today. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and great is his holy name. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we ask and pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. God bless you. Go in peace. We'll see you next week.